Hello again, everybody. I'm excited that we are going to get to continue to hear from some of our guest speakers for our summer series. And tonight we're going to be able to hear from Neil Mathis. Neil has been preaching for the Tompkinsville, Kentucky congregation for a little over 6 years. And prior to that, he was working as a youth minister for about 10 years in Ohio as well as in Henderson, Kentucky. And Neil, tonight is going to be presenting us a lesson from Daniel chapter 5. And so I look forward to hearing this lesson tonight along with you, and I hope that you will benefit greatly from what Neil has to say. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to him.
Hello, Southside. I'm so very happy to be with you tonight. I'm sure that Brian and Jackson have introduced me and let you know who I am. But I am very grateful to be with you. I'm just Neil, and I'm a good, I think, old-fashioned, reliable, and relatable Kentucky boy. I was born and raised in Bowling Green, spent years working in Henderson, and the western part of our great commonwealth holds a very special place in my heart. You know as well as I do that the Lord's people are special over there, and I am just grateful tonight to get to spend a few moments with you as we talk about one of my favorite books of the Bible. Daniel has been, from the time I was little, something that inspired me and helped me really grow in my appreciation of who God is. When I was a child, learning about Daniel being thrown into the lion's den, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego standing up to the king when he built that great statue. When I saw the stories of these men, I thought to myself, man, that's very impressive. And now as I've grown older and I'm entering close to 30 years as a Christian, I'm starting to see that what they did was almost unheard of. How they stood up to kings, to powerful men, how they threw their life on the line, and how they remained faithful to God in spite of incredible circumstances. We should be able to appreciate, especially with what we have faced the last few months, the difficulty in being God's children in a world that doesn't always appreciate that. Thankfully, our circumstances have not been persecution, just inconvenience. And we haven't had to face what they had to face, but I pray if we ever did. If there was ever a king that sat on the throne of whatever country we lived in and told us to abandon God, to reject God, to bow down to him, that our response would be the same as theirs. No, I will not. Now, Daniel chapter 5 is a unique kind of middle ground for the book. See, we have action, we have characters, we have events that are unfolding, and it's still a great vacation Bible school story. But it really leans into some of the weightier and deeper, and let's call it what it is, sometimes confusing parts of the book. When the handwriting on the wall, when the interpretation that no one but Daniel can reveal, when the judgment comes, Daniel is really at its essence describing why God is sovereign and everyone else should bow down to him. Now, the story of Nebuchadnezzar, when he became essentially an overgrown man cow, should have been the final straw in the teaching and the understanding that all of those Babylonian kings following him would have ever needed to know God is more powerful than they are. Yet when we meet Belshazzar, probably Nebuchadnezzar's grandson and someone who ruled the kingdom with his father in a bit of an equal share, he's forgotten about God. He's forgotten about Daniel. And he has overlooked the lessons that his grandfather learned through difficulty. So if you have your Bibles, may I encourage you, turn to Daniel chapter 5. For the sake of time, you know as well as I do that we can't read all of the verses, but I want to look at sections, and I want us to see how it connects from point A to point B to point C. So let's start there in chapter 5, and let's read the first four verses together. Notice that it says that Belshazzar the king, he made a great feast for 1,000 of his lords and drank wine in the presence of that thousand. While he tasted the wine, he gave command to bring the gold and the silver vessels which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken from the temple which had been in Jerusalem. And the king and his lords and his wives and his concubines may drink from them. Verse 3 says that when his servants brought those vessels that had been taken from the house of God which had been in Jerusalem, and the king, his lords, his wives, his concubines had drunk from them, that they did not just drink wine in verse 4, but they also praised the gods of gold and silver, bronze and iron, wood and stone. In these four verses, we see a terrible atrocity occur. And that atrocity is idolatry and blasphemy. Every day in our world, we see it happening more and more. People say God doesn't exist. When the things God has taught are old-fashioned and outdated and worth ignoring. When people look at the standards God put into life that are just common sense, respect for one another, respect for what he has said, for the things that are decent and honest. We see blasphemy every day against that. And we see idolatry rising more and more in our country and in our families when other things get the priority God should get. When we see this, it should remind us that it's not too difficult to lose your place, to lose your sense of what's right and wrong, and it's not impossible to lose a sense of propriety for understanding who you are and who God is. You don't have to be a king and a powerful man to let idols take over. You don't have to be a master of thousands and tens of thousands to ask the people who follow you, who love you, who are influenced by you to do what's wrong. All it takes is you forget what it is God has done and the lessons that he taught your fathers. In these four verses, we see the whole story set. And you might look at it and you might say, well, this is who he was. That's who he had been. And I think that's probably true. You know, the New Testament tells us by our fruits we are known. You know, when you see what we do, who we are, then you get a good idea of what's going on here and what's going on here. Belshazzar seems to be a man who had everything but realized nothing. May we never be that person. In verses 5 through 9, we see God respond to what was going on. And you know how it unfolds, but let's look at a couple verses. It says in that same hour, verse 5, that the fingers of a man's hand appeared and wrote opposite the lampstand on the plaster of the wall of the king's palace. And the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. Now, many times in Scripture, miracles happen. Miracles that are supernatural. They are beyond our explanation or the explanation of nature. Miracles, like the Red Sea parting and the Israelites walking on dry ground. Miracles, like the sun stopping in the sky so that Joshua and his men could fight longer. Miracles. Now, we don't see them anymore. When a baby's born, it's not a miracle. When a person who was sick gets better, it's not a miracle. When there are things we can't explain, it doesn't mean it's a miracle, because it's not always God stepping down into this world and saying, stop to nature. But this is one of those moments. And our appreciation for not just what's happening should be found in why it was happening. For miracles were almost always given to prove not just that God exists, but what God said matters more than what the world thinks right now. So look at what the handwriting did. It says in verse 6 that the king's countenance changed. His thoughts troubled him so that the joints of his hips were loosened, his knees knocked against each other. He cried aloud to bring in the astrologers, the Chaldeans, and the soothsayers, the wise men. He spoke to them and said, whoever reads this writing, tells me its interpretation, will be clothed in purple, will have a chain of gold around his neck, and shall be the third ruler in the kingdom. That's a pretty good deal. And when all the wise men came, and all the astrologers came, and every person of Babylon who thought they were something came and tried to tell the king what it meant. Notice in verse 8, they could not read the writing on the wall or make known to him its interpretation. Verse 9 says it made him even more troubled. His countenance was changed. His lords were astonished. In this world, my friends, a lot of times we meet people who describe themselves as experts. But they're not really experts. See, they don't know anything, but they've become, because of an inflated ego, they've become an expert unto themselves. And sometimes they can pass off knowledge and wisdom as expertise. But my friends, no one knows better than God. And so many times people in this world have been like Belshazzar and have been like his wise men. And when they have been confronted with God's wisdom, they bang their head against the wall because they do not listen. They try to tell God what they know to be true instead of letting God be the one who dispenses, who displays, and who teaches what truth is. There's a reason Jesus said, I am the way and I am the truth and I am the life. He wasn't trying to say that he was a truth. He was trying to say he is the truth. God has always been the truth of this world. And when we forget, he does a really good job of reminding us. Now I do wish that in 2020 there were more instances of writings on the wall. That the people who stand up in pulpits, behind podiums, on television, who stand as experts on what's wrong with everything, would realize what's really wrong is that we're a lot like Belshazzar. We're blasphemous and idolatrous. And as a society, we have forgotten all the lessons God taught our fathers. Maybe what we need is more handwriting on the wall, and for knees to shake and countenances to change. In verse 10, Belshazzar's mom appears. And Belshazzar's mom is Nebuchadnezzar's daughter. And Belshazzar's mom offers the first bit of wisdom in the story. She says in verse 10, "Do not let your thoughts trouble you, nor let your countenance change, because there is a man in your kingdom in whom is the spirit of the holy God. And in the days of your father, light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, were found in him." King Nebuchadnezzar made him chief of the magicians, chief of the astrologers, the Chaldeans, and the wise men, and the soothsayers. Let him be called. Bring him here, verse 12 says, and he will tell you what the writing on the wall means. Sometimes, my friends, what we need in this world is not just God's wisdom, but the wisdom of the people who either know him or have seen him. We're not really sure how much her belief in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, how much was there. But we know she saw what happened to Nebuchadnezzar. And we know that she remembered all Daniel had done, that Nebuchadnezzar placed him in a position of power, and she knew where he was, that he was still around. Sometimes we need to just remind the world, God never forsook us and never abandoned us. You just forgot to look for him. You just discarded him. You're the one who pushed him away. He didn't push you away. I love that Belshazzar is smart enough to heed her advice. You see, verse 13, it says that Daniel was brought before the king, and the king told him, "Are you Daniel who did all of that? If you can tell me what's written on the wall, I'll give you what I promised those earlier." You know what he says? I'll clothe you in purple. I'll put a chain of gold around your neck, and you shall be the third ruler in all the kingdom. Daniel's promised the same thing that those other men were, because I think Belshazzar is desperate. He needs an answer to what has happened. And even though he doesn't know Daniel and he doesn't believe in Daniel's God, desperate people take desperate measures. Thankfully, in this moment, his desperate measure and his Hail Mary at the end of the story is the right one, and the one he should have taken at the beginning. And had he listened to Daniel and known Daniel and known the stories of his fathers, might have never been in this predicament to begin with. Daniel says in verse 17, "Let your gifts," I love this, "let your gifts be for yourself." He says, "I don't want what you're offering. Give your rewards to another, but listen. I'll tell you what the writing on the wall means." And Daniel gives Belshazzar a history lesson. Perhaps that's what a lot of people need today, a history lesson. Notice that he tells them in verse 18, King Most High, O King, the Most High God gave Nebuchadnezzar, your father, a kingdom. And God gave him majesty, glory, and honor. Because of the majesty that God gave him, all peoples, nations, and languages trembled and feared before Nebuchadnezzar. Whomever he wished, he executed. Whomever he wished, he kept alive. Whomever he wished, he set up. Whomever he wished, he put down. But when his heart was lifted up and his spirit was hardened in pride, he was deposed from his kingly throne, and they took his glory from him. Then he was driven from the sons of men. His heart was made like that of the beasts, his dwelling like that of the wild donkeys. They fed him with grass like oxen. His body was wet with the dew of heaven. Till he knew, till he understood, until he honored and respected that the Most High God rules in the kingdom of men and appoints it over whomever he chooses. Belshazzar did not know that history was repeating itself. And so are a lot of people in this world lost when life happens. We're not the first people to live through a pandemic. We're not the first people to live in a world that is forgetting God. And we're not the first people who must remain faithful. Elijah thought he was alone. You remember the story from 1 Kings? But what did God tell him? No. There are 7,000 people who haven't bowed. I think sometimes the apostles and the early church probably felt very alone when they were in jail, when they were being persecuted. But we look back now and we realize that there were churches all across the known world. And today, my friends, even though we seem to be so vastly outnumbered, there's so much strength in our numbers, so much we can accomplish. For you're not alone and I'm not alone. May we never grow weary in doing what's right. And may we remember that the Lord has always been here and has always been here for his people. And he's always taught lessons to the people who rejected him. And history is meant to be for us a connection to God. You remember when the Israelites crossed the Jordan River, God told Joshua, take 12 stones and make a pile, basically. And he says, when your children ask what happened here, you will tell them that Israel crossed on dry ground. Those who fail to appreciate and learn from history are doomed to repeat the mistakes of their fathers and their grandfathers. Belshazzar was doing the same. And when Daniel tells him this has already happened, and your father learned his lesson, you can almost sense the irony. And you hope that what Belshazzar's doing is learning. Why didn't I pay attention? Daniel goes on to say in verse 22, Belshazzar, you have not humbled your heart, although you knew this. You have lifted up yourself against the Lord of heaven. They have brought the vessels of his house before you. You and your company have drunk wine from them, and you have praised your false idols of gold and silver and bronze and iron and wood and stone, which do not see and do not hear, and the God who holds your breath in his hands and owns all of your ways, you have not glorified. He made the same mistake so many have made. He thought he was the center of the universe. And he believed when all those people told him, you're the most important thing. He's about to learn that was a big mistake. Verse 25. This is the inscription that was written. Mene, mene, tekel, upharsin. And this is the interpretation of each word. Mene means God has numbered your kingdom and finished it. Tekel, you have been weighed in the balances and found wanting. Peres, or upharsin, your kingdom has been divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. Now, what has always shocked me about this story is that the minute Belshazzar hears this, what makes sense to me is that he would have executed Daniel, thrown him out, and said, I don't want to hear that. But instead, his response is the complete opposite. It says in verse 29, then Belshazzar gave the command, and he did what he said he would do. They clothed Daniel with purple, put a gold chain around his neck, made a proclamation concerning him that he was now what? The third ruler in the kingdom. Of everything in the story, that's what doesn't make sense to me. Maybe Belshazzar just finally learned his lesson. And the reality of everything that was happening sank in like it should have. Maybe he was shocked. Maybe there was a bit of relief. What I hope is that there was guilt and repentance. And that he was overwhelmed with all he had done that was wrong. There's a part of me that hopes Belshazzar in that moment went back in time and remembered the story that his grandfather had told him. That he saw the error of his ways and he repented and prepared himself for the judgment that was coming. That's what I hope happened. Today, what I want you to see as we have thought about this wonderful vision is the lessons that come from it. First one is simple. God is sovereign. He is the one who is the ruler of this world, this universe, our being, everything that came before and everything that will go after. The one who, Daniel says, holds our life, counts our ways, who knows us. Second big lesson, don't let yourself ever be the center of the universe that you worship. When you become the deity in your life, you don't just forget God. You exalt yourself to a place you were never made to be. And when you're the center of the universe, my friends, the real world is falling apart all around you. And third, what might be the most important, when God speaks, listen. God's been teaching our fathers and our forefathers for thousands of years. And he's still teaching us today. Are we listening? Are we reading our Bible? Are we worshiping? Are we living a life that is transformed? Are we renewing our mind every day to be who it is he wants us to be? Have we put aside all of the things that so easily ensnare us? And are we running the good race, looking to Jesus, the author, the perfecter, and the finisher of our faith? I pray today that this lesson teaches us one very important thing. You are not more important than God. Never let anyone, especially yourself, believe that. I'm so very thankful that you let me be a part of your summer series. I pray it's been a blessing to you. I love Daniel chapter 5 and the whole story of the man who stood up to kings and said, God is more important than you. May we remember that today in our life, to tell everyone and everything, God is the most important thing to us. I will listen to him above all else. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful evening.
Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. Rescue me from the wicked.